What is up guys, Star Studio here. Today I'll be doing a set review on Secret Slayers. For North America, Secret Slayers is coming out tomorrow. Europe will have to wait a little bit, we'll get it April 16th if all things go according to plan. Can't really blame Konami for this, there's kind of a situation going on in the entire world. But yeah, that doesn't stop me from trying to review this set. So I haven't done a set review before, so small introduction to the format I will use. I will talk about the archetypes in the set, the new ones. After that, I will talk about the generic support, and then I should tell you if it's a good set or bad set, and if you should buy it. So there are three archetypes: Rika, Ada, Mancipator, and Eld Leech. It's called, I believe. I have the names written down a bit lower on my notes, but Eld Leech is the name, if I recall. So let's talk about Ada Mancipator. So first off, Konami, what is his name? Ada Mancipator. At first, the fan translation was Adamantia, which was still pretty somewhat hard name to get right, but they just made it unnecessarily long for no reason at all. Adamancipator. Try saying that 5 times in a row without missaying it once. That's impossible. So it's a decent archetype from what we've seen so far. I personally tested out the archetype a lot recent days, and it could be rogue. I personally doubt it, but it has a lot of potential due to Rocks just having very good generic support. But most of all, they're a very good engine. In generic Rock decks, it's just very good. The basic idea is that you can always just use the two good tuners, Researcher and Seeker, in any deck, get a free tuner special summon. They can dig for an extra summoning of a Rock. The extra deck monsters in general are alright, but they're mostly good as an engine in my opinion. They're not entirely a good deck. This is mostly due to the non-tuners kinda being bad and the synchros leaving room for something more, like they're not that great. One thing I do want to mention is that Block Dragon can search Researcher, Seeker and any level 4 like Gigantus. And Gigantus will special summon itself by banishing Block Dragon, for example. Let's say you don't run Earth for Block Dragon. And I can just summon these two tuners. You don't even have to use their effect. A Block Dragon will result in two level 2 tuners and a level 4 for basically free. And these tuners are Earth, so that's an Aetheria Barkion that's very generic. And if you can somehow use Hulky Fibrax to go into... what's his name? Recover. You have very easy access to the Aetheria Beast and Barkion knocking out 2/3 of your opponent's deck. As an engine, they have a lot and lots of potential to be abused. I mean, Onion Carrier exists, you don't have to summon Block Dragon for this to work. They can just banish the Block Dragon with Gigantus. And now any deck suddenly has access to two free level 4, level 2 tuners and a level 4. For basically free, I mean, you need to go into Onion Carrier and control a dragon or earth monster. And you need to send some to the graveyard somehow, so there are some ifs, but as an engine it has a lot of potential. Now one of the issues is that the non-tuner main deck monsters are just awful. Only Dragite is good because it has a draw effect. If you summon it off an Adamantia effect, you get to draw a card. Hard ones per turn, obviously. I mean, if it didn't have one, holy shit. But yeah, the other two main deck monsters just aren't good. The other level 4 tuner, Researcher, I believe he's called. No, it's not Researcher, I believe. The level 4 tuner. Anyway, isn't that good either because you have to normal summon it. Well, you can special summon it if you go second, yeah, but if you go second, you're most of the times locked out of playing, so good luck with that. The synchros are very mediocre. Most of them don't do enough going first, and they only have great effects on your opponent's turn. The exception here is Reptide. Which is really, really good, actually. Especially if you're running a high number of Researcher and Seeker, you can just dig for another copy of one of those for free and just go into Savage Dragon or Crystal Wing with a level 6. And its materials are generic. This is a very good card for Rock decks that have access to tuners, which isn't a lot, unless you're me. I play Gemknight Synchro, I play Konomali Synchro. Two decks, well, Gemknight's a good deck, but Konomali. Yeah, no. Yet can make devastating boards using these cool new rocks called Adamancipator. So they have a lot of potential to help other rock decks. Adamancipator Science is also generically really good. It's just a monster reborn for any rock without the once per turn that summons them in defense, without negating the effects. I mean, that always has potential usage. The traps, in my opinion, are just forgettable and not that great. So, all in all, Adamantipator is nice at the moment. It has potential as a deck, it has a great engine combined with Block Dragon. But it's not enough to be meta in my opinion, and maybe with future support it could be, but as it is right now, you know, you should still pick them up because they're really good as an engine. So next up, Rika, usually first called Snowflower, but the official name is Rika. I like the rename. I actually like Rika as a name. Snowflower, it sounds uninteresting for some reason. Rika, once you get used to it, it's a nice name, so props to Konami for that. So there's one huge misconception around Rika, and that's the plant restriction. Well, the deck isn't that good because you can only go into plants, you are locked to plants. No, you are not. One common theme I see a lot online is that people misplay Rika a lot. They either play it too pure or their end ports are just lackluster because they don't know how to build the deck. Not a direct shadow, like not meant to be an attack, but I saw for example MBT's list and the 10-minute testing of Snowflower. I wasn't impressed. I think that list was mediocre at best, same actually for the Emancipator. I think these decks have a lot more potential than people are currently finding, than people give the deck credit for. They are using the wrong builds. I'm not saying my Rika build last build was perfect either, but a lot of people misplay Rika. They try to play it as a pure plant deck, control deck. It's not that. It's a good engine for a combo deck, which just basically makes the combo plant engine. That's the best way to use Rika at the moment. Currently, there's no justified reason to run them pure. The cards they offer that lock you into plants aren't good enough to run them purely. However, this might change in the future depending on future support they get or indirect support. The one thing that makes them really good is that they have their own reinforcements of the army with a bonus effect. You can just search any Rika, and this spell is searchable of another one of the Rikas. But if you tribute a monster, you can also search any plant with the same level as the Rika you searched, and they benefit a lot of tributing. Evil Throne, for example, is a great card to tribute. One example, by the way, of them just not being good enough as a pure deck is their Exceeds. Both have a lot of potential, but both just aren't good enough. Yeah, a quick play tribute sounds neat, but it does not negate effects. If they summon something like, just a random example, Straddles, they will still get the search. So if you're playing Rika at the moment, this might change in the future, but if you're playing them at the moment, you're playing them as a plant combo deck. Playing a pure variant is just not giving credit to the deck on its own. It's not good as a pure deck at the moment. So Rika have a lot of potential, maybe the most potential out of all these decks. But as it is right now, they're mostly a plant combo deck, which isn't necessarily bad, but it's not good enough. They're definitely the weakest deck out of this set at the moment. And finally, we have Eldritch. And Eldritch, really, really solid deck, actually. They are currently meta in the OCG. I'm not sure about the tier in the OCG, because to be fair, with the whole situation, pandemic thing going on, there's no clear tournaments there anyway, so take any tournament results with a grain of salt. TCG doesn't even have any real tournaments, so yeah. But what we saw from them in OCG was very impressive. And I mean, honestly, Cursed Eldlin, one of the first cards, is insane. It's a continuous spell that almost searches anything in the deck. It doesn't search elixirs, but it searches any monster-related card, basically. It's basically a better contract with the gate, the DD card, because you have to pay to keep it up. With an additional effect, like, that's just ridiculous. Because if it gets sent to the grave, you can send another card from the deck to the grave. Which is, like, it's a better dark contract. Like, what? Dark contract with the gate is what made DD good for a part. So that's a very good card already. They have Elixir of Black Awakening. And it's really good, too. It's a kind of a hero lives for zombies. If you control the Eldritch, else you just have to summon the Eldritch. With no life points cost, with some restrictions in it, though. And you can banish it to set any Golden Land spell trap from the deck, like, what the fuck? Like, a Hero Lives is at 1, well, this is not exactly the same as Hero Lives, but you get the idea. A Hero Lives is at 1, and this is a Hero Lives that also has a Banish to Search effect. That's ridiculous. So, Elixir of White. It's the same graveyard effect, but instead of being a hero lives, it's a quick play monster reborn, and that's also really good. Elixir of Scarlet Sanguina is just Black Awakening, but then as a trap. Which has its benefits and negatives. Being a trap is always a bit slower, but this is a control deck and trap tricks exist. So this is a very solid card, and then we also have Guardian of the Golden Land, which is a trap monster. If you control the Eldritch boss monster, you can make attack of one monster permanently zero, which is just a free bonus effect, basically. Again, banish it from the graveyard to set any Eldritcher, the good search spells, the good A Hero Lives, I mean, not search spell, the A Hero Lives spell and trap, I mean, these cards just do so much, they bring a lot to the board. Then you have Huaquero, if I butchered that name for sure, which is a DD Crow and a body, and it has search as well, under the condition that you control an Eldritch, of course. You have the Conquistador, which just pops any face-up card, which does not target, by the way. It does not target, that's could be relevant. I mean, it also has the same search effect, so it's like, what? How is this card a thing? There's also Golden Land Forever, which tributes one zombie monster that control an Eldritch to basically have a Solemn Judgment. It does not have a graveyard effect though, that's a bit of a shame. But again, counter traps plusing makes no sense looking at your Stellanoids that continuous trap. Their counter trap is disgusting. Eldorado, Adelanto, which is a normal trap. So, once again, potential usage with Trap Trick. Shuffle 3 Eldritch spell traps with different names into the deck that are banished. Destroy everything on the field. Just everything. Destroy it all. That's pretty good. It's other effects that you can shuffle back 3 Golden Land spell traps with different names. Half the opponent's life points. And then gain life points equal to their life points. Like, what? That's a weird effect, if you ask me. But the archetype in general is very weird. It's apparently meta. I have a hard time saying anything about it. I mean, OCG also has 3 skill drain, which definitely helps them. In general, though, yeah, I think Eldritch also has a lot of potential. I mean, it's meta there, so yeah. And so far, the 3 archetypes are really great. Let's talk about the generic reprints. So I will only highlight the good reprints. We have Doki Doki, which is very good for rock decks. You will run it in Adamantipator, but also in other rock decks. Block Dragon, which is honestly busted. How is this card legal? It's like a Dragon Ruler for Earths, without a monster per turn, with 3 searches. This card is nuts. How is this card actually a thing? Like, how does Block Dragon still exist? I'm pretty sure it one day will get banned, but until then, solid card, you want 3 copies, and yeah. It's in Heroes reprint, so that's nice. It only really had 1 print, I believe, or maybe 2, and those prints could be bought out if the Emancipators became good, so good call can have to reprint this. Rose Lover is generically good for plant combo. I ran 1 copy, some people run 2 copies, but it's good for plant combo decks, so reprint never hurts. Lonefire Blossom reprint, it's always a good card to have a playset of. If you don't have a playset of Lonefire Blossom, you definitely want a playset soon. Get it sooner than later, the price is probably fine at the moment. Unizombie is always nice to have for any zombie deck. I mean, if you're playing zombies, you're most likely running Unizombie in some way or form. Upstart Goblin is actually a really big reprint. If you don't have 3 copies of Upstart, get your copies of Upstart right now. This card hasn't really seen a reprint in recent years. And now you can just get it super for not that high of a price. So get your copy of Upstart Goblin. Galaxy Cyclone is a weird reprint, but I guess this card never hurts to have either. And Solemn Judgment reprint. I mean, that's also very nice. It's a good card to have 3 of. If you don't have 3 copies of Solemn Judgment, get it. And then there's Trap Trick, which is always a good reprint. I mean, if you don't own Trap Tricks, get your Trap Tricks. So, in general, 3 promising archetypes. I mean, Eldritch will immediately probably be meta, or at least Rogue, or Contender. Rika is mediocre, but with right support, who knows. I mean, Plants will always be good cards. Emancipators are hard to judge at the moment. They have a really high ceiling for their potential. solid deck, even better as an engine. I'm personally not sure how abusable they are at the moment. Future support might actually break this deck, like make them actual tier 1. So what you have in this set is 3 solid archetypes and good reprints. I mean, you can't ask much more from a set. I mean, no real terrible cards are in here. There are some cards that are like, why? I mean, Kaoki Meru cards aren't good. I've seen some people play them in Adamantipators, which is just stupid. They're not good. Not in Adamantipator either. But I guess reprint makes sense. I mean, I don't think many of those cards had recent reprints. But yeah, all 3 decks are at least playable. It's a good set. Probably the best set we'll get this entire year. Yes, it's better than Dual Overload, because Dual Overload is a lot of trash, like Cubics and Malefics that are just not good. If you are planning to buy any kind of Sealed product this year, get this set. I think Secret Slayers is the best set of 2020. I mean, there's no guarantee, of course, we don't know what's in Battles of Legends, but Battles of Legends hasn't been the greatest since the Light's Revenge one, I believe, was really great with Minerva in it. This set, Secret Slayers, will always give you 4 supers and a secret, so you always get foils. So your chances of winning here are already high. Then there are some really valuable cards in here, a lot of cards you would want to get your hands on if you have interest in all 3 of these decks. And they're good decks. We don't know what the upcoming sets will do, they might support these archetypes more and break them, so it never hurts to get your hands on these. So buying Sealed product is always a gamble, and Konami is shady because they do short print cards, even in this set. They aren't doing it anymore in main sets apparently, but this is a side set, so different real set, we still get short prints. But if you are investing in any kind of Sealed product, Secret Slayers is the set you should be investing in. Decent chance of winning, 3 solid archetypes, very good reprints like Upstart and Solemn Judgment. I mean, I don't know what more to say. I'm not even sponsored by Konami, but I'm saying if you're buying a Sealed product, which is a decision that you can agree or disagree with, some people don't like buying Sealed, some do. But if you want to buy a Sealed product, get Secret Slayers. Now, I know there's an epidemic going around the world, so it's, well, pandemic, I don't know the technological term, I'm not going to mention it because I don't want this video to get demonetized. Oh, but you're so greedy, well, I mean, the little money I do make off my small channel, I mean, can you blame me? I mean, at least I'm not adding mid-video ads, which a lot of YouTubers are, which I don't blame them for, but I'm just, yeah. That's an entire different discussion, but, like, the point is, if you are looking to buy a Sealed product, get this. I mean, Yu-Gi-Oh! Will resume at some point, eventually. We don't know when. And 3 great decks and 3 and good reprints. There are almost no bad cards in this set. Yeah, short prints are always gonna be a thing, but that's how Yu-Gi-Oh! Works. Even unless you're buying cases, even with main booster sets, without short prints you still have a chance of just only getting bad secrets anyway, so. So if you're looking to buy any set, get Secret Slayers. I think Konami did really great with Secret Slayers, they did a good job. No unnecessary reprints like Pot of Extravagance in here, it wasn't needed, because the set itself was actually good. Considering the fact that Eternity Code is a bad set, Rise of Duelist will be worse, and we have no idea about the set after that. If you're planning to buy any Sealed product anytime soon, get yourself copies, a few boxes of Secret Slayers, or some packs, or buy singles, whatever you like. But this is definitely a set to watch. Hope you guys enjoyed the video, different type of video than usual. See you guys next time, Stars Yu-Gi-Oh! Signing out.